When two astrophysical objects go up against each other, one usually comes out on top. Red giant stars incinerate planetary systems, but neutron stars cannibalize their red giant neighbors, and stellar mass black holes rip neutron stars to shreds. But supermassive black holes eat all of the above for breakfast. So what happens when two gigantic black holes tango? We may be about to find out, because astronomers report spotting a pair of them in a close binary orbit for the very first time. Today on Spacetime Journal Club, we're going to dig into a paper that reports the detection of a pair of supermassive black holes orbiting only one light year apart from each other. We've never seen such a binary system this close together before. This is extremely cool because we knew for a long time that such tight binaries must exist, but it's taken until now to spot one. Studying the dance of these giants should tell us a ton about how black holes grow. Now, this paper was just published in Nature Astronomy by Preeti Kab and Dharam Virlal from India's National Centre for Radio Astrophysics and David Merritt from the Rochester Institute of Technology. Before we get to this new result, let's talk about supermassive black holes, SMBHs. These things live in the dead centres of pretty much every decent-sized galaxy. Now, we've already talked about the black holes that form in the deaths of massive stars. They start with masses of up to 10 or so suns. The ones in the cores of galaxies contain the mass of a million to a billion suns. The largest have event horizons that would envelop most of our solar system. We're still figuring out how supermassive black holes got so big. Did they get most of their mass from eating gas and stars from their surrounding galaxy? Or do they mostly grow when smaller SMBHs find each other and merge during galaxy collisions? We know a lot more about the first process because we've been watching SMBHs munching on their host galaxies for half a century now. This is what causes the quasar phenomenon. On the other hand, we know very little about merging SMBHs. In fact, this new observation may turn out to be a pair of supermassive black holes as close to merger as we've ever witnessed. If so, it's incredibly important for understanding that whole aspect of black hole growth. Actually, let me say a bit more about quasars. We talk about them in more detail here, but the TLDR. When gas from the surrounding galaxy falls into and feeds the central supermassive black hole, you get an active galactic nucleus, AGN. Quasar is the term for the most powerful AGNs, and they contain SMBHs with up to billions of suns in mass. But lower down the power scale, we have Seyfert galaxies, which typically contain a single SMBH weighing in at millions of solar masses. Now, the purported binary black holes in this new study were found in a known Seyfert galaxy. That means they're feeding on their surrounding galaxy and they're approaching merger. So we get to see everything happening at once. Let's talk a bit about how these binary black holes were found, because it wasn't easy. The Seyfert galaxy in question is Markarian 533, which is around 400 million light years away. The black holes are around one light year apart in the center of the galaxy. In order to measure such a small separation at such a large distance, we need resolution around 100 times better than the Hubble Space Telescope. Kab and collaborators achieve this using a technique called very long baseline interferometry. In short, the target is observed with radio telescopes on opposite sides of the planet, and phase differences in the incoming radio waves are used to find the origin of each wave with incredible accuracy. In fact, the spatial resolution is equivalent to what you would get with a telescope equal in size to the separation of the radio antennae. Now, in this case, the Very Long Baseline Array, VLBA, was used, and its antennae span Hawaii to the US Virgin Islands and through the continental United States to give an effective antenna size of over 8,000 kilometers. Here's the radio map at 15 gigahertz frequency. Those two hotspots are the locations of the possible black holes. Now, black holes themselves are invisible, so what we're actually seeing here is radio emission from jets. Let's talk about AGN jets for a minute. When a black hole feeds, the vortex of infalling plasma, the accretion disk, can produce a powerful magnetic field. that field can accelerate narrow streams of high-energy particles away from the black hole. Those jets can blast through the surrounding galaxy and beyond, carrying their magnetic fields with them. The radio light seen here is from electrons spiraling in those magnetic fields, so-called synchrotron radiation. Now, this map alone doesn't tell us that there are two black holes. We frequently see separate knots of radio light in AGN jets, which can splutter as their fuel supply changes, or as the jets smash into denser regions of the surrounding galaxy. In fact, we see such hotspots in Makarion 533 when we look at a much larger map. Here, we can see two bright spots far from the black holes, presumably from a burst of jet activity some time ago. So, how do we know that the hotspots in the core are from two unique black holes, instead of a lumpy jet from one black hole? Well, the researchers tested this by looking at multiple frequencies to get a crude radio spectrum. Typically, knots and lumps in a jet have a pretty even energy distribution. Spiraling electrons produce radio waves at lots of frequencies, all the way down to very low energies. But right down near the black hole where the jet begins, we think the matter should be so dense that the lowest energy radio waves have trouble escaping the jet. Now, this is a process called synchrotron self-absorption, and it causes the base of AGN jets to be much fainter at long wavelengths. That is exactly what's seen here. Both knots have the classic energy distribution of a completely independent jet launching point. The extreme energy densities observed are also what you'd expect from the bases of two distinct jets. The only way this is possible is with two separate black holes, each one powering its own mini quasar. Okay, let's assume the researchers are right and we've spotted supermassive black holes in a tight binary dance. How did this happen, and when will they merge? Like I said earlier, we already knew this sort of thing must happen. I mean, galaxies grow by merging with each other, and the SMBHs of these galaxies must eventually fall towards the new merged galactic core. This happens through a process called dynamical friction. Basically, the black holes slingshot stars outwards through gravitational interactions. Each time they do that, they lose a bit of orbital energy or angular momentum, causing them to fall deeper into the gravitational well. You can think of it as a sort of gravitational friction dragging the black holes downwards and towards each other. However, by the time the black holes are only a few light years apart, there shouldn't be any stars left in between them. That means they stall and fall into stable binary orbits around each other. In fact, we still don't know how supermassive black holes merge once they're within one parsec or a few light years of each other. Now, this is called the central parsec problem. We know they must merge, we just don't know how. One possibility is that gas can provide the needed friction beyond that point. The newly discovered binary definitely has a reservoir of gas. After all, that's how it powers its jets. So perhaps it'll give us the answer. A lot of you are probably thinking, what about gravitational waves? Can't gravitational radiation cause supermassive black holes to merge, just like it does with regular stellar mass black holes? And can LIGO see those waves? The answer is no, and no. Oh, this system is definitely producing gravitational waves, but it's going to take many billions of years to lose enough angular momentum to merge that way. And while those waves may be powerful, they have an incredibly low frequency, something like 1/10 trillionth of a hertz. LIGO is sensitive to gravitational waves from 10 to 10,000 hertz. This binary is just too huge and slow to register with LIGO. There may be ways to detect the actual merger of a supermassive black hole binary with a galaxy-sized gravitational wave observatory called a pulsar timing array, but more on that another time. For Makarion 533, we're going to have to stick to traditional observing methods. Longer exposure radio observations will pin down the energy distribution to confirm whether these really are jets produced by two black holes. Now, this galaxy is so dusty that it's hard to peer into the core at other wavelengths of light. However, careful observations of the stars in the galaxy can help us figure out the masses of the black holes and look for signs of galaxy mergers. And if this binary SMBH is the real thing, then it's certainly not the only one. This finding will inspire astronomers to search for more of these dancing giants, leading us closer to understanding the incredible growth of the largest black holes in all of space-time. As always, a huge thanks to everyone supporting us on Patreon. Every little bit really helps. And today, an extra shout out to Justin Lloyd. Justin, your contributions at the Quasar level have been an amazing help. As such, we're renaming your personal Patreon contribution the Markarian 533 Binary Active Galactic Nucleus Fund. We will spend it exclusively on animating black holes and quasars, and also pizza. Thanks, Justin. Last week, we talked about the intriguing possibility that the fundamental constants of nature are changing. You guys had a lot to say. Nevermind asks whether the fundamental constants are connected to each other. Well, the answer is we just don't know. The Standard Model of Particle Physics contains 26 independent parameters, things like the coupling constants and the masses of each particle type. Now, these can't be predicted, they need to be measured. These are like the tunable knobs of the theory. However, we don't know how they ended up with the values that they have, and presumably a deeper theory explains this and may connect them. In this theory, the value of some constants may prove to be tied to the values of other constants. A few of you took issue with my suggestion that changing fundamental constants help with the fine-tuning problem. Either that the fine-tuning problem isn't actually a mystery, or that the enthropic principle solves the problem without even changing the fundamental constants. To answer, I would ask you to imagine that the entirety of our universe, or even the multiverse, has the same laws of physics, including the same fundamental constants. Assuming then that the universe wasn't set up specifically to be able to produce life, then is it not just too lucky that the only universe that exists is a life-supporting one? The alternative is that many universes or patches of universe exist that encompassed an extremely wide range of physical states. Then only a small fraction would be capable of supporting life. And of course, we're in one of those. Wispex Legend asks where a 15-year-old Australian should start to pursue a career as a physicist. Well, it sounds like you're already studying the right stuff in secondary/high school. Keep that up. Take whatever math and physics they offer. To become a working physicist, you're going to need a PhD. So that means university/college. Start a Bachelor of Science degree somewhere with a decent physics program. Major in physics and work your butt off. Get good grades and you should be able to win a scholarship for a PhD program. Keep working your butt off and you'll be making real contributions to physics before you even finish your doctorate. You should also talk to teachers and even contact university physics departments to get more career mentorship. Robinohm suggests that the three-component SU2 boson field in the electroweak Lagrangian should have had mu as a superscript instead of a subscript. Wait, we're summing over the superscript mu in gamma as per the Einstein summation convention. Is Einstein out the window now? Is there some new Robinohm summation convention that we should talk about?